what's happening, everyone? It is I, the man, the myth, the mustache, Tim here, and have I got a video for you. Welcome to part 18 of What If Deku Was Trained by Stain? Sit back, relax, enjoy yourselves, because you are in for a treat. So let's get this story going, shall we? The five young students sat on the train, with Yayorozu focused on the receiver in her hands. The coordinates indicate Kamino Ward, Yokohama City, and Kanagawa Prefecture. Our travel time will be about 2 hours from here, so we should arrive at about 10 o'clock, she explained to the others. All right, that gives us enough time to plan this out. We'll have to prepare to avoid being spotted right away. That way, we actually have a chance to get in and out without any risk of a fight. Midoriya spoke with a fine-edged focus. He knew of Ida's feelings, while also well aware of how dangerous things would get if they were spotted. Todoroki looked thoughtful and offered up his own concern. Unfortunately, they all already know what we look like. Yayorozu snapped her fingers. With a smile, she explained her plan for costumes. Despite the serious situation, the students were quite excited for the idea of an undercover-based plan, and promptly practiced their acts. Ida and Midoriya were a bit more serious about the situation for their own reasons, though. Despite this excitement, everyone went back to the original conversation at hand. Meanwhile, many of the top heroes were slowly gathering. Each had received their own phone calls requesting their presence for the plan. While elsewhere, Stain stood on a rooftop, with several of his top followers behind him.
Sir Stain, are you certain of this?
Spinner knew well enough about their mentor and leader to know what he had planned was nothing to be uncertain about. Though something about the plan they had, it just didn't sit right with him for some reason.
Of course I'm certain. A child was taken right where we were actively fighting. What heroes would we be if we didn't get him back?
The look in his old student's eyes from the night he had attacked the other blue-haired boy echoed through Stain's mind. He had deemed so hastily of the boy's lack of heroism and punished someone wrongfully. Since then, he had been filled with doubt of his own recent actions. He had done his best to find a new way for his goals to be completed. He had decided to go about things more differently. This plan was just one of the newer changes he decided to proceed with.
Besides, I owe the League another visit, he simply said,
and motioned silently for the group to follow him as he set off towards his goal. Sometime later, a broadcast of a conference with Mr. Aizawa, Nezu, and Vlad King would go up. The teachers, along with the principal, apologized for recent events that happened with Bakugo. The group tried their best to answer questions as they came. Bakugo, who had minutes ago been rebound and captured due to his last outburst of an attack, watched the broadcast from his seat. His eyes twitched with annoyance. He knew well how his teacher felt about the media, and the fact it was all about his classmates, and himself, likely to anger his teacher. The young bombshell only grew more irritated by the moment. Shigaraki turned off the TV after questions were asked. He seemed pleased, and looked at Bakugo.
The heroes are failing, and that's to be expected. After all, the public and rules of society claim all must be perfect, even though no one can truly be expected to be perfect, right? According to the rules, if you aren't perfect, then you're a loser. If you're a loser, you are to be shoved aside and ignored, unloved, and vilified. Soon enough, questions will start to be asked such as, what is a hero? What is justice? And is society even fair?
Then they'll all start crying like little babies just like you?
Bakugo interrupted with a twitch in his eye, his head tilted back and a lift of his chin. His gaze never once broke from the man covered in hands before him, and he continued.
Talk about heroes and justice all you want, but you freaks all seem to forget. You're the villains. You kidnapped a teenager on a school trip, then slowly started to bore him to death with all your stupid yapping. So, why don't you just shut your trap before I kill you all?
Bakugo shouted out and looked amongst the group. He challenged any to speak up, to give him a reason to lash out again. Dobby looked silently towards the blood-crazed girl Toga, who finally lost her smile. She now stared at Bakugo blankly. Both she and Dobby had joined the group, hoping to change the world for people like them. But it seemed the girl now thought the same thing as Bakugo. Could they really make the world better when they followed people like this? Who actively kidnapped children to make heroes look bad? There had to be a better way, right? Shigaraki frowned and turned to look at a screen behind him.
I hoped we could come to an understanding. But if we can't, we must move on, Master. Lend me your power,
he requested. The man on the other end, shrouded in darkness, smiled widely at the request, pleased with his student's decision. Elsewhere, the group of five were walking outside when they heard a reporter's voice chime out from a massive screen. "How do you know the villains aren't planning on pulling him towards the path of evil? Can you really sit there and tell us that the boy still has a future?" the reporter simply asked. The five now undercover students stopped their walking and looked up to the broadcast. The students looked on with concerned looks as they watched the massive screen. Their teacher bowed to the cameras, only to apologize for not having helped Bakugo tame his anger and violent nature better. Aizawa looked right at the reporter, then to only inform him that if the villains believed they had any chance in turning the young boy to the side of villainy, they were grossly mistaken. The reporter continued to press on, which caused Midoriya's anger to boil to the surface. He clenched his fist to try to keep himself focused. "Yayorozu." The others looked from the broadcast to Midoriya, all visibly tense. "Where to next?" His words helped the group remember their initial task. The group set back off in the direction of the signal, which grew stronger as they approached a building, where the signal was coming from. Yayorozu nodded to them to indicate they were there. Iida shot Midoriya a look, a simple one, but one that was only to remind Midoriya that if things got out of hand, he would do everything in his power to withdraw them all. Midoriya knew the possible dangers. There was even a risk that Bakugo possibly wasn't even inside the building before them. Midoriya slowly fell deep into thought, while quietly muttering to himself as he tried to come up with a plan. He needed to figure out what was going on inside, in a stealthy manner the best they could. Though with the current given team, it would be more tricky. Kirishima and Yayorozu locked eyes for a moment. Kirishima rubbed the back of his neck, and Yayorozu shrugged, but both looked back to Midoriya, waiting. Midoriya figured it best to take some time to scope the place out while still undercover. This way the group could take in as many notes as possible. After a thorough search, they could tell that everything about the building showed it was abandoned. If it wasn't for the tracker that signaled its location from inside, even Midoriya would assume that no one had ever been here in ages. Midoriya eyed the front door, and based on how the weeds were laid, there could possibly be a hidden path elsewhere while the front door was set up to be a trap. The group slipped away to a hiding place to gather their thoughts. Todoroki was the first to point out how public the location really was. Given the looks Midoriya had attracted now from his weapons he had insisted to carry on his person, the group had thought most would believe him to be a strong arm of the group, but failed to think about how they still may attract unwanted attention. Midoriya was a bit regretful of such an oversight, but knew it would be worse if he was stuck in a position again without weapons, like last time. The group moved along in conversation and decided they needed to check out the back of the building. It was the best chance to find something currently. Once the group found a window, but it seemed too dark to see inside properly. Yayorozu offered to make something only for Kirishima to stop her. He shared with the others he had brought his night vision scope just in case. Midoriya was pretty impressed by how prepared he was. The group then decided to have Kirishima as the scout, with Midoriya as backup. The others hoisted the two up. Kirishima nearly fell over in shock at what he had seen inside. Midoriya looked concerned for his friend, who passed the night vision scope to him next. Midoriya quickly looked inside, and readied himself for the worst possible outcome, only to feel the warmth in his body wash away what he saw. This was a far different kind of worst-case scenario than he had expected. Before his very eyes were multiple rows of containers that held Nomu in each of them. Midoriya felt a cold sweat form along his skin. Ida's voice brought him back into focus. "Midoriya, what do you see?"
"Nomu."
"A lot of them, too," Midoriya replied, and looked down to the shocked expressions of his friends' faces. Meanwhile, Shigaraki looked back to his followers.
"Compress, pack up the boy. We need to get moving,"
Shigaraki said, and motioned to Bakugo with a lazy hand. A bead of sweat rolled down Bakugo's face. He needed to get out before he was relocated again. He didn't know if the heroes had any leads on his location or not, but moving around so soon wasn't a good idea. And besides, it seemed like they were about to go and cause more trouble, so the last place he wanted to be was stuck in some stupid ball while they did it. Compress nodded and adjusted his glove. He stated how he wished the young boy had been a better audience member while he walked over, only to stop in his tracks when the young Toga hopped over the counter to get between the two, much to the other's surprise. Stares were traded between them for a moment before Toga gave a smile and shrugged.
"So, how about you all let me stab him just a little real quick?"
The thought made her blush, but she pressed on.
"His delicious blood could prove useful, you know. Just in case."
Shigaraki slowly turned towards Toga in reaction. Bakugo's eyes saw that she had shifted into a more battle-ready stance, along with one of her hands that slowly moved towards a hidden blade on her upper thigh. The moment of silence was brief, but felt like an endless battle between them all. Each and every one of them debated what the other would do next. The villains wondered what exactly Toga's true reasoning to intercept Compress was. The moment ended when a knock came at the door.
Hello, pizza delivery?
The collective heads turned to the door that exploded inwards towards them all.
Of smash!
All Might was here.
Toga took this moment to flip backwards and place her palms on Bakugo's head to help her complete her flip over him, which allowed her to land right behind him. The heroes swarmed the villains quickly. Toga released Bakugo's restraints, who promptly sprung forward just as fast as he was released. All the while, the villains hurried to react, but were all bound in wood too quickly to do much of anything. Bakugo looked back towards Toga, who inhaled and winked at him. She held her breath, then vanished from sight. Dabi went to try and free himself with his flames, just for Gran Torino to shoot in and kick him promptly, which stopped him. Gran Torino then launched back towards the other two heroes once more. All Might proudly declared,
"No more running, League of Villains, because we are here now!"
The villains watched in shock as several more heroes made their way in to help secure the scene. All Might explained how the press certainly worked like a charm to get the villains to actually think they had no idea where the hideout was. It was soon revealed that police and the number two hero Endeavor had surrounded the building. All Might gave Bakugo a thumbs up and took a reassuringly yet joyful tone.
"You must have been scared, but you did quite well despite this, young Bakugo."
"As if I'd ever be scared of these losers,"
Bakugo shouted back in annoyance. The only one more annoyed than Bakugo in this moment was Shigaraki, who looked over the situation quickly. His plans foiled again, given the final boss of his game suddenly appeared, his troops all captured, and even one of his said troops just betrayed him and ran off. Somewhere. There was far too much commotion to try to figure out exactly where she had gone off to. Well, wherever she was, she wouldn't last long.
"Kurigiri, warp over as many as possible," he shouted, certain that his plans were still possible.
"The Nomu, right?"
All Might asked with a wide grin, which caused Shigaraki's eyes to grow wide.
"No, they couldn't have," Shigaraki thought to himself.
All Might proceeded to explain to Shigaraki how he had much to learn, and the second half of their plan, much to his dismay. They had known all along of both locations, and now, with another team of heroes, taken out the Nomu factory alongside their main operation. Thus now, the villains no longer had any backup ready to help them.
"It's over, Tamura Shigaraki,"
All Might declared proudly.
"No, it's not over yet. If you truly think you've got this, you've already lost, Kurigiri."
Not much more could be asked of Kurigiri. He was knocked out by a hidden hero. Gran Torino reminded the villains that they all really did need to take the heroes seriously. He proceeded to list off each of their real names, though paused as he failed to spot Toga. Gran Torino gave All Might a glance to signal him that there was one missing, but he continued on without skipping another beat. He explained the police had gone out of their way with as little as information as possible to learn their true identities, and that there was nowhere for them to run. Shigaraki tensed up. He thought back to one of his old talks with All for One, from when he was much younger. He had been there for him then. He wouldn't just abandon him now.
"It's not over. Just you wait and see. I'll still win this game. I can still win!"
he shouted as many Nomu came from seemingly nowhere, which shocked the heroes. All Might instructed the heroes to stand strong. Black ooze started to form around Bakugo. All Might reached out for him, catching a glimpse of Toga, who gasped for air. The girl looked to be in mid-leap. She seemed to appear out of nowhere, only to be swallowed up with Bakugo in the goo as well.
"No!"
All Might shouted, then looked out towards the police, who fought their own battle with the Nomu currently. Much to his surprise, a group of mysterious people leapt down from the rooftops brandishing swords. The group helped the police fight off the Nomu as best they could, with surprisingly great skill to All Might. He didn't linger too long on the sight. All Might turned instead to fight off the Nomu in his immediate area. With the grit of his teeth, he figured it was All for One who brought them here, who finally had made his move. All Might shouted again and ran at Shigaraki, who was enveloped by goo and swept away along with the other villains before he could reach him. Rage filled All Might, but as any pro hero should, he turned back to the fight once more. He made quick work of the remaining Nomu in the room by hitting them down to the streets, where Endeavor finished them off. All Might proceeded to talk to Endeavor for a moment, before Endeavor instructed All Might to go after him, and that things were covered here. Stain, the leader of the mysterious group, looked over having heard them talk about the situation, and figured him to be Bakugo. He looked back to Spinner with a nod. Spinner nodded back to his leader, and both knew what to do at this point. Seeing All Might head out, Stain followed after, quickly leaving Spinner to lead the other members of the team without him. He watched All Might as he followed. Stain knew he may not be able to keep pace with a powerhouse's speed, but so long as he kept sight of him, he'd be able to find him. Wherever he was going, Stain knew there would likely be a fight, and All Might's showy fighting style was one that would make it easy for him to find even from a mile away. He needed to help. He needed to help to get the boy back and help the true hero. Back at the other location, Ida, Yayorozu, Todoroki, Kirishima, and Midoriya looked on in shock, while another group of heroes stood before All For One, unknowing of who the man was, but knew he was nothing good. Best Genist moved to strike as quickly as possible, much to Mount Lady's disapproval. The attack triggered All For One to set off an explosion that enveloped the entire area in a large dust cloud. As the dust cleared, all that was left was a large clearing, and the heroes spread out around the outer ring of it, all badly hurt and unconscious. Best Genist was the only one who fought to stay conscious. All For One began to clap and commend Best Genist's efforts, who looked on at him in fear and shock. He pushed on through this in order to attack once more, in hopes to do anything at all to stop the villain. Sadly, he only received a killing blow from the masked man. Cold sweat and fear washed over the students who hid in shock, disbelief and fear. The man had just taken out so many pro heroes, and even right now killed one with seemingly little effort. They all knew they had to run, but physically couldn't out of fear. There soon came a splash-like sound, which caused the five students to look over at the direction it came from. Before them was Bakugo and Toga, who was gripped onto Bakugo, coughing. There he was, the friend they needed to save, placed right next to All For One, the mysterious man who just displayed his power, and was not one they would ever dream of taking on at their current strength. Toga looked up to see the glares and silent stares from her old comrades, while Bakugo saw his captors, rather than the heroes who had surrounded him moments ago. Both only had one thought on their minds, and voiced them at the same time.
Crap!
And that's our video, so thank you all for watching and indulging yourselves in our story thus far. I hope you have enjoyed it, I know I have. Now, there are a few more things I want to go over with before the video ends. First, we have a second channel called Anime Deep Dive. Anime Deep Dive goes over the hard facts and lore of a wide variety of anime, which is sure to expand your weeb knowledge of all kinds, guaranteed. On top of that, we have a third channel called We the Celestials Naruto What Ifs. It's what we do on this channel, but in the vast world and lore of Naruto. So go check that out if you're in the mood for some jutsu action! Secondly, on behalf of We the Celestials, I want to thank everyone involved in the production of today's awesome content. Their details will be in the description below. Finally, if you're interested in what we do here at We the Celestials, then I want to extend an invitation to join our team. We only have one caveat, you must be 16 years or older to join our crew. You can sign up for whichever category fulfills your interests by joining the recruitment Discord in the description below. Our Discord is an all-around fantastic place to be, whether you're a fan or you're looking to join our band of misfits. So that's it for today's video. So thank you all for watching, and I do hope you have a great day. And before I go, I do hope you are taking care of yourselves mentally and physically. I am glad you are still here with us, even if life has been very difficult for you. You are your first priority. Keep that in mind. If you have someone who says that you don't deserve happiness, they are wrong. You deserve happiness and love all the way. And of course, do be kind to others. You really never know what someone is going through. And with that, this has been Tim. Mustache out.